Molt bona tarda, senyor Ignasi López, representant de l'obra social de la Caixa. Benvolguts consocis, senyores i senyors. L'Ateneu, com saben, és una entitat més que centenària, però això no significa que sigui una entitat ancorada en el passat. Al llarg de la seva història sempre ha volgut, en moments molt claus, estar a la punta dels esdeveniments que es produïen i la interpretació dels esdeveniments que es produïen en el país i en el món. No cal dir, tothom estem aquí una mica per aquest fet, no?, que hi ha una inquietud per els canvis que s'estan produint en la realitat mundial i d'interconnexió, i estem en aquest sentit molt satisfets. Jo simplement volia dir això, donar-los la benvinguda. Estem molt satisfets de la col·laboració, d'una nova col·laboració amb la Caixa per poder posar endavant aquest cicle Futurs, que el seu nom ja ho indica, és el plantejar-se els grans reptes que tenim en aquest moment. Al llarg de la història també les grans ideologies han volgut interpretar la realitat. Ara tenim una mica la sensació de que ens falten eines per poder-nos adaptar, per poder-nos realment enfrontar a problemes que s'estan plantejant constantment i que s'estan interconnectant. O sigui, que no són un problema determinat, sinó que és un problema que afecta a tot, a la vida quotidiana, als grans plantejaments, a la possibilitat de recuperar ideologies, el que sigui. Per tant, en aquest sentit, després ja els aniran parlant del cicle i del plantejament, és per nosaltres una veritable satisfacció poder inaugurar ara aquest cicle de Futurs en la seu de l'Ateneu. Gràcies.
Gràcies, president. Benvinguts. Res, simplement destacar també, doncs, que per nosaltres és un plaer posar en marxa aquesta col·laboració. Jo sóc Ignasi López Verdaguer, sóc director de l'àrea de ciència de l'obra social de Caixa, i va ser una cosa que vam començar a pensar, doncs, per aquestes raons, en el nostre cas també perquè a CosmoCaixa aquest any fem 10 anys i ens plantejàvem, aquesta és una sèrie d'una actuació que entre d'altres intenta també celebrar aquests 10 anys, perquè bueno, des de CosmoCaixa ens plantejàvem què podem oferir també. Hem fet molta reflexió sobre què és la ciència i com es presenta, i ara ens plantejaven, després d'aquests 10 anys, doncs, intentar ajudar a la reflexió sobre com podem enfocar els propers. No? O sigui que per l'obra social de Caixa i per CosmoCaixa aquesta col·laboració forma part, està enmarcada en aquest àmbit d'actuació. És un plaer, saben que algunes de les conferències d'aquest cicle succeeixen aquí, unes altres succeeixen al Palau Macaya, que és el nostre centre de reflexió sobre les coses que afecten a la societat des de molts punts de vista. Moltes gràcies a vosaltres, moltes gràcies al conferenciant. Avui tenim un conferenciant d'absolut luxe, tant ell com la persona que l'entrevistarà, la Milagros Pérez Oliva, i moltes gràcies sobretot a vostès per assistir a aquesta conferència i a les properes. Gràcies.
Bé, bona tarda a tothom. Benvinguts al cicle Futurs. Ja sabem que el futur no es pot predir, seria pretensiós per part nostra pretendre-ho, però sí que es pot intentar albirar com quallaran les tendències del present. El problema és que els escenaris canvien tan ràpidament que sovint no tenim ni temps de reaccionar. Tenim la sensació, suposo que a vostès els hi passa com a mi, que el terra es mou a sota dels nostres peus. I si haguéssim de definir amb una sola paraula la idea que tenim del que ha de venir, probablement aquesta paraula seria incertesa. La revolució imparable de les tecnologies digitals i el procés de globalització econòmica i cultural han produït una acceleració dels temps que ens provoca angoixa i moltes vegades inseguretat. Entrem en l'era de la hipercompetitivitat. Com diu el professor Inerarity, l'experiència de canvis accelerats que vivim en el nostre dia a dia fan que la relació amb el futur col·lectiu no sigui tant d'esperança i de projecte com podia ser fa un temps, sinó de precaució i de prevenció. Fins al punt que hauran observat, com remarca la filòsofa Marina Garcés, que molts dels moviments que avui sedueixen els joves i no tan joves es defineixen més per la paraula stop, Stop Wall Street, per exemple, o en conceptes com aturar, defensar, decréixer, que per la paraula acció, sovint segrestada per un poder que la vol monopolitzar. Però val la pena aturar-se un moment i mirar el futur de cara. Quins són els reptes als que ens haurem d'afrontar com a societat al llarg del segle XXI? Com podrem participar en la construcció de l'avenir i afavorir els escenaris que creiem que es poden ser més positius? Aquestes són les preguntes que vol ajudar a respondre el cicle Futurs que organitza l'Ateneu de Barcelona i l'Obra Social de la Caixa, en un total de 7 sessions focalitzades en els àmbits més rellevants: les noves tecnologies, el control de la informació, la política, l'economia, el medi ambient, la salut, l'educació, la cultura, per tancar amb una sessió on abordarem les megatendències que es marcaran d'aquí a l'any 2050. 2050. Encara que sembli llunyà, no ho és tant. Recordeu, els que teniu aquí més edat, com de lluny us va semblar en algun moment de la vostra vida l'any 2000. I ja fa 14 anys que l'hem deixat enrere. Per iniciar aquest cicle, tenim l'honor de comptar avui amb una de les persones que més es pot ajudar a reflexionar sobre les transformacions que porten les noves tecnologies, Eugeni Morozov. És molt conegut, segurament han llegit els seus llibres, però haig de fer, encara que sigui breument, una presentació. És un referent indiscutible en la reflexió sobre l'impacte que les noves tecnologies de la comunicació tenen, no només sobre la vida de les persones, sinó també sobre les estructures socials i polítiques i la pròpia democràcia. Nascut a Soligorsk, a Bielorússia, l'any 1984, és editor col·laborador de The New Republic i escriu regularment, hauran pogut comprovar-ho, els diaris més importants, els diaris de referència al món: The New York Times, The Economist, The Wall Street Journal, Financial Times, Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung i El País, entre d'altres. Ha estat professor visitat de la Universitat de Stanford i investigador de la New American Foundation i de l'Institut Open Society de Nova York. I és autor de dos llibres que han estimulat extraordinàriament el debat sobre la revolució d'internet. El primer, publicat a l'any 2012 i traduït a Espanya amb el títol El desengaño d'internet, los mitos de la libertad en la red, de l'editorial Destino, on desmunta el mite de que internet hagi de ser un factor que contribueix necessàriament a la democratització mundial. I el darrer, que és To Save Everything, Click Here, del 2013, on adverteix contra el mite del solucionisme, la creença que la tecnologia ens ho resoldrà tot. És una veu crítica que refusa amb vehemència l'etiqueta de tecnòfob i que, amb la que se l'ha volgut tillar des de certs sectors perjudicats per les seves crítiques, però que avui ens explicarà per què és una de les veus més escoltades en aquest moment a tot el món. Gràcies, Eugeni Morozov, per estar aquí i teniu la paraula. Gràcies.
Okay, well, thank you very much for coming. It's very good to be back to Barcelona. Those of you who have heard me before know that I tend to speak very fast. I guess that's why the organizers just put me through 4 hours of interviews so that I at least slow down a little bit in my final talk, but I'm not gonna give up. So if it's too fast, just let me know. So I'll have one big scissors for the talk tonight, and in some sense it's very simple, but in another sense I think it's very profound, and the scissors is this. The questions of who owns the data that is generated as we use more and more devices that have sensors in them, that are so-called smart devices that are present in our soon coming self-driving cars, that would be present in our smart thermostats that Google promises to us. Everything that has a sensor will produce some data. Who owns that data will be the key political and economic question of the day. It will shape how we think about the welfare state, It will shape how we think about public services. It will shape about how we think about the future of politics as such. It's a very ambitious thesis, and I hope I'll defend it. But to do that, I'll start with an anecdote that some of you may have seen in an article I wrote recently about data. And the anecdote is about a young Dutch student called Sean Buckles, who basically decided to do something very creative and ingenious. Seeing that a lot of big internet technology companies are exploiting the personal data that he provides while he uses Gmail, or while he uses Google Search, while he uses YouTube or Google Calendar, he decided to go one step further and basically auction off his data to the highest bidder. So he said, anybody who wants to have access to my data, whether it's for advertising purposes, or whether it's for the purposes of, I don't know, running some big data analytics, or whether it's for the purposes of studying him as a patient, or as a student, or as a citizen, can just come and pay him a certain price. And for that price, they would be entitled to access all of his services, his email, his calendar, his notes for a year, right? So essentially, the guy said, pay me a certain sum of money, you will have access to all my data, because essentially data, as he thinks, has become a commodity and an asset. Well, he got more than 20 bids for that offer, and eventually he ended up selling it for, I think, 350 euro. That's the price that he managed to get, of course, with a lot of media exposure. But the underlying core message that his action sense, I think, is very interesting, but also to some extent disturbing. And it's that a lot of the activities that we engage in, as long as they are mediated by digital technology, do generate a data trail, and the data trail does have a value, right? We do not yet have a nifty, accurate need formula that will allow us to understand what that value is, but that value is clearly there. Even if a lot of technology companies are trying to convince us that it's basically has no value and they just take it from us for free, right? And arguably, I would say, that explains the immense valuations of companies like Google or Facebook on the stock market, right? Their valuations are not tied to the actual profits that they generate. To a large extent, they're tied to the expected value of the user data that they have accumulated. Right, but the basic premise behind the act of this young Dutch student, I think, is interesting. And it's that there is a lot of data. We are not capturing it ourselves. We need to capture it, make money, become entrepreneurs. Let's unwin this agenda. That's one option. Everybody becomes entrepreneur. You try to steal, or at least get the data back from the companies, and then you try to resell it. And as we know, there'll be plenty of firms, companies, advertisers who would want to buy it. So that's option number one. Everybody becomes a data entrepreneur. Option number two is presented to us by companies like Google. And their argument is also very interesting and intriguing. And what they basically say is that the more data about us they accumulate, the more accurate their services are. And the more accurate the services are, the less hassle there is in our life. The easier it is for us to find things, the easier it is for us to travel, the easier it is for us to navigate whatever it is we want to navigate with our Android phone in our pockets. So by integrating data from every single possible service and device, Google can actually derive, and I hate that word, synergy, right? That it would not be able to derive if it were just, you know, a bunch of data streams that were owned by individuals and they were not brought together under this great analytical engine that Google has. So Google's argument essentially is the more data they have and the more it is coupled with their superb artificial intelligence, the better insights they can get. And the end of this logic is itself, I think, very clear if you think about it. The more Google knows about you, your habits, your consumption, your location, your various susceptibility to risk, the more it can predict what kind of information you might be needing right now, and what kind of information you might be needing in the future, right? So Google's model for the future of search will actually disrupt search altogether. If it were up to Google, you would not even need to go to Google to search. Google will find you and tell you what kind of information you need at this moment, right? And that is only possible if Google has access to everything about you already, right? And I would argue that this is already the strategy that informs a lot of Google products. So if you look at their most recent and flagship product called Google Now, which is an app that is not only available on smartphones, but also now available in your Chrome browser, this is exactly how it works. It analyzes everything you do in your Gmail, it analyzes everything you search for, it analyzes your location, and based on those data points, it provides you information that you haven't actually asked for, right? So in my Google Now, right now, I have a little card that tells me that I have a flight to Berlin tomorrow and I have to leave the hotel at 5:50 in the morning because based on Google's projection for traffic in Barcelona, that's the best time to leave. And they know the fact that I have to catch a flight because they have access to my email, right? And they constantly analyze it. And they have the same cards for, you know, that they know if I'm standing next to a cinema hall, for example, they will tell me what are some of the film listings, right? How do they know this? They know that because I have been to movies in the past, I have looked up films in the past, and I'm standing right next to the cinema, right? So Google makes a prediction based on the information that they already have about me, about what it is that I would want, and bring that information to me, right? If you think about it, it entirely disrupts how search functions. And it's not gonna work for some type of specific searches. When you search for, you know, for example, some specific book, you'll still be taken somewhere, right? But for a lot of searches that do have to do with our location, our travel, weather, location, and so forth, Google would be able to do a lot of this kind of predictive search in advance, right? The reason why I'm bringing this up is that it shows you very clearly what the second paradigm for thinking about data is. And the second paradigm of thinking about data is that big is beautiful, right? The more data you're allowed to accumulate within one particular entity, the better are the insights, the better it is for the consumers, right? And Google knows how to frame this debates. So the way in which Google has been framing these debates in the last few years has been that its main task and its main goal and its main reason for existence is to basically give you more time. They can generate time out of thin air because by analyzing everything that you do in advance, they can save you from making those unnecessary clicks that it would take to go to your Gmail, find your reservation for your flight, check the traffic conditions, check what films are out there. All of that Google does on its own, essentially finding a way to convert data that they gather about you into time. Right? That's the magic trick. You take a lot of data and you figure out how to produce time savings for individuals. So from the perspective of consumer efficiency and consumer welfare and antitrust law, you know, there is a strong case to be made that what Google does, even though they're sucking in all of our data, is benefiting consumers. And that's the argument that Google has been pushing in the European Commission and somewhere else. Right? So we are stuck between these two options. On the one hand, we try to wrestle and we try to get as much data as we can from these companies. We assign property rights to this data, right? And we start trading in it, right? Thus capturing some of the value that otherwise goes to these companies. Option number two, we let these companies accumulate as much data as possible because we think that the more data they accumulate, the better predictions they can yield. And Google and similar companies will provide all sorts of examples informing the public that if we take our data away from them, the ability to make predictions about important trends, like the spread of diseases, like the possibility of terrorism, like the possibility of predicting where, you know, floods might happen, or whatever. All of that essentially comes from amassing this amount of data. So there is a public reason, and they have some point here, that, you know, can be unlocked, it can be untapped, can be generated if that data stays with them, right? Well, that's essentially the two positions in which we are in. I would argue that a lot of people, a lot of smart people, a lot of people who are otherwise critical of Silicon Valley have embraced the first option of turning everyone into entrepreneur as and having everyone own their data as the most preferred option that exists today, right? And they essentially argue that instead of letting companies get away with it, we should find a way to empower the people. I would say that I think we should probably agree with the first proposition that it's good to recapture some of that value. The question that I'm not yet sure about is to what extent the only response to this question and the only response to this problem is to erect private property rights around that data, right? And what I mean by this is that if you think about it really hard, if you do have a way to take the data that you generate when you are using any smart object, right? You know, and that data is generated, whether you want it or not, you know. And again, I've given these examples many, many times. Some of you know them by heart, but all of these new consumer objects like smart toothbrushes, like smart readers, all of them generate data, right, which can underwrite even some of the costs of those objects. So companies are happy to give you some of those objects for free or at a subsidy, right? Because the data that is generated in the context of using them has a value of its own because it's eventually tied to advertising, right? So, but that data is generated, right? And the question I think is, if you think about it, and if you try to universalize this principle, what happens to your subjectivity, what happens to your individuality, what happens to your humanity, if you want to put it that way, as you start not just accumulating this data, but trading it in real time? And what happens is that essentially your entire everyday life is being financialized, right? Because everything that you do can be approached from the perspective of financial value. Because every single act that you do generates a data trail that somebody is interested in buying and acquiring, right? Somebody wants to know what kind of song you whistle in the shower every morning, right? Because that might be a good way to sell you another shampoo in the afternoon, right? The reason why we weren't able to capture that song and monetize it was precisely because we never had sensors in the shower, right? Because we either didn't have a phone with us, with sensors, or we didn't have smart energy, smart water, smart everything surrounding us in everyday life. Now that we move to a society where we do have sensors that capture everything, right? Virtually everything now is up for grabs, right? And virtually everything has a value, but that value is not static, right? Because the value of a certain data point about you varies based on who you are and where you are and based on what the needs of the market are. So, you know, if Google knows or predicts based on my previous searches that I'm really in the, I feel like going and buying, you know, shampoo, and I walk by a supermarket, the knowledge of that fact is much more valuable when I'm next to the supermarket than rather than when I'm 2 miles away, right? So the value of our data portfolio, if you will, constantly fluctuates. And it's not stable, it varies. And its value also increases as you accumulate more and more facts, right? As you start adding more and more data points, the ability of other data points to make sense also greatly increases, so there is no limit as to how much data you can add, because the value of the previous data points that you have already accumulated changes dramatically when you add new ones, right? And that's entirely the principle according to which data collection at the NSA works, right? And the NSA, they just don't have a principle by which to delete data anymore, because they never know how valuable certain pieces of data might be as you introduce new bits and pieces of data, right? So that value in itself is cumulative, but it's also always in flux, it's always changing, right? And my anxiety about accepting the entrepreneurial solution is that it will essentially extend, to simplify and maybe banalize it, the neoliberal paradigm into the most remote corners of our everyday life, so that virtually everything that we do becomes, if not dominated, then at least punctuated by our relationship to the market, right? And that, by the way, also why I feel so uneasy about some of the current excitement for the sharing economy, where the operational logic is not very different. If you think about it, what has Airbnb and Uber accomplished was to essentially create, turn that capital into capital that is productive. And what I mean, that's always participating in the market. And what I mean by that is that, you know, in the past, when your apartment or your car or any of the other resources that now you can easily put onto the market and rent, or as the industry calls it, share, right? Previously, you just couldn't do it, or it would take prohibitively, it would be prohibitively expensive because you'll have to go and every day put an ad in the newspaper. I mean, right now, your assets that have previously become debt are no longer debt in that, you know, they are categorized and marked, and they're always available for the highest bidder. So you're actually turning your entire asset class, if you will, into property that is always available there, and that you yourself are always available. If you think about how some of this task-focused services like TaskRabbit, for example, in America, and I'm sure there are very similar alternatives in Europe work, I mean, what you're doing with your own time is something very similar to what you're doing with your apartment on Airbnb. You're just saying that, well, I'm available to perform various services, and I'm always there to do it. And the kind of anxiety that it generates, even when it does provide the monetary benefit, I think itself something that we need to treat much more seriously and debate. Because to present it as a way to earn some money, and that, by the way, is also the argument that we often hear in defense of treating data as a private property, the fact that it helps to generate some money does not detract us from the political, economic, and social consequences of actually reducing our social and communication and interactive mutual relationships into something that has monetary value attached to it, right? And I think we should actually think about it much more profoundly, because the way in which individuals and governments have embraced it in itself is a sign and a consequence of the economic crisis in which we are living. And it's the same with the data, and it's the same with the sharing economy. Just because you can make certain assets more productive, and just because you can derive more value from the same or less resources by putting in feedback loops, information loops everywhere, should not detract us from questioning the fairness and justice of the initial allocation and distribution of those resources, right? But what's happening right now is that individuals, of course, have realized that both data and, you know, intangible stuff, the data, the thoughts, the activities, but also the tangible assets and thoughts and activities and sort of cars and houses and things that you can now share with the sharing economy are tradable assets, right? So you can derive value from it, and you know, if you don't have any other alternative, of course you'll sell everything, and like in your data will be the first thing to sell, right? Because you think that it actually has no influence upon your life. Why not sell it, right? If somebody wants it, why not sell it, right? And we can debate what the consequences of accepting that premise are, and I think a lot of people make a mistake by not realizing how personalizable and personalized their social and political and media environment would become if every single player, or even if some players, have access to your most intimate data. I mean, it's not a question of privacy and surveillance, even. It's a question of to what extent the choices and decisions that you make will actually be your choices and decisions. Right? Because the kind of options you would be presented with will always be the options that are generated with just one goal, and that goal is to make money by whoever shows you those options based on your personal data. Right? And I'll return to that. But the reason, so the citizens are embracing all of this for a very simple reason. It's an extra source of cash at a time where other sources of cash have dried up. The government's embracing it for actually the same reason. So I don't actually expect governments to step in and do much in terms of regulation, because governments have realized that data is some kind of deus ex machina. It's something that can actually help them balance the budgets or get close to it by, again, treating it as an asset. So you see moves, for example, in the British government to take the patient data that is available via National Health Service and try to put it on the market to generate some revenue, which can then make up for the budget deficit. You see the same efforts, of course, they generate a lot of anxiety and scandal and whatnot, but the basic move there is very simple. Governments have realized that they themselves are sitting on a lot of data, and the more data citizens produce, the more economic activity is there, and the better it is for everybody involved, at least the governments. Right? But it's the same with all sorts of other data, student data, you name it, right? And so for that reason, I don't actually expect to see much regulatory action, because for governments, data is the last frontier of privatization. I mean, essentially everything else, almost everything else has been privatized. And at this point, the next move is to basically think about ways to privatize and monetize the data that they already have, right? Whether it's gonna be through some kind of privacy by design access, where, you know, only trusted intermediaries will get access to it. I mean, that to me is what's gonna happen, right? There might be some temporary provisions specifying that you can only use the data for research purposes and so forth, but the governments are not gonna let that data sit idle. For me, this is very clear. So it leaves citizens in a very precarious situation, because to me it's clear that we are only at the beginning of this data revolution, even though I don't like the term revolution that much in the context of the digital, because I think many of them are overstated. In this case, I think it is actually entirely normal to speak of a completely radical change and break from the past, because the costs of fitting everything with a data generating sensor have fallen dramatically, and there is a lot of money to be made in it. So for me, it's a given that within a 5-year horizon, there will be far more devices in your life that not only generate data, but that also aggregate data. And, you know, depending on which side wins, the entrepreneurs who want to collect and sell it, or Google, which wants to collect and keep it for its own purposes, the data is gonna be there, right? And the question then is, if you don't buy into the entrepreneurship model, which essentially colonizes and financializes your everyday life, and if you do not buy into the biggest beautiful model of Google, then what is the third alternative, right? And I think this is where we really get into a lot of interesting questions. And here we get into the role that cities can play. We get into the role that entities like trade unions can play, because a lot of the data, by the way, will be generated by people who are employed, right, somewhere, and a lot of that data will be data that is generated in the workplace or outside of the workplace. I mean, just think about it, this new generation of iPhones that can track your health data. I mean, how would that impact what happened in the workplace? I mean, that's an entirely separate discussion, but again, I would not exclude traditional institutions that have had a role in defending at least some social groups from consideration here, especially when we're thinking about the world of work becoming far more flexible and distributed. But the basic point I'm trying to make here is that there is no reason to think that the only ownership model that is available to us is the private ownership model. I mean, you can also easily imagine social ownership for some of that data, and to start treating data not as a commons, but as a common, right? And that would put data actually at the heart of many of the transformative social and political projects that a lot of social movements try to engage in today. And I think if we don't solve that question, if we don't understand the way in which, on the one hand, technological infrastructure, but on the other hand, data infrastructure are going to shape how the modern state functions, we are gonna lose all of the other fights, right? And what I mean by this is the following. If you think about, again, governments, and if you think about the ways in which a lot of social and public services are provided now, you easily imagine that by monitoring everything that you do, which is a possibility thanks to the smartphones and smart gadgets that we carry in our pockets, you can move a lot of social services in an entirely new mode that embraces very different logics when it comes to health, for example, right? So the model of healthcare that we are talking about within the 5-year horizon is the preemptive model, right? And it's a preventive model. It's actually, you know, it's hard to figure out whether it's preemptive or preventive, but the idea is that more and more of traditional responsibilities for health and healthcare will be shifted to the patients, because the patients already have the ability and the means to monitor everything that we do and to be warned early about potential problems, right? So right now, the way it works is that instead of waiting until you develop some symptoms and you go to the doctor, the idea is that your smartphone, by monitoring all of your physical activity, food consumption, and so forth, will actually start informing you that certain problems might appear in the horizon if you don't radically alter or change your lifestyle. Right? And if that's the paradigm, then it also allows us very easily to punish the people who do not adhere or conform to certain rules, which, again, a lot of the social services with their shrinking budgets would be very happy to see happen. If you look at Britain, for example, you will easily see that there, where the neoliberal project is much more advanced than in many other European countries, you already see plenty of think tanks producing reports that actually embrace this preemptive model, arguing that, for example, your health benefits should be tied to your lifestyle, right? And your lifestyle, of course, now can be monitored through your phone, and as long as your lifestyle is monitored through your phone, you can actually have a very flexible system of deciding who it is that deserves care and whether we should actually pay certain people who have had deliberate steps, who have made deliberate steps not to act on the warnings shown to them, can we actually punish them? So one of the reports I looked at recently suggests something like this, that essentially people who might be obese and who are getting health benefits or insurance benefits from the state covered by national insurance should be entitled to them only if you can actually detect through the smartphone or some kind of a smart card that they actually go to the gym, right? And you might think that this is crazy, but that's an actual think tank report. And you know, you can see how and why it appeals to a lot of public services. It appeals for the simple reason that it introduces some basic notion of fairness, which is, of course, fairness defined in very neoliberal terms, but it also allows you to save a lot of money, right? First of all, you save a lot of money because, hopefully, through continuous monitoring, you tell people not to do certain things and, you know, to start caring about this issue sooner. And second, you can actually punish those who do not adhere to what is considered the good program. And I would argue that this proliferation of our ability to monitor and our ability to accumulate data into reputation, right, is going to change profoundly how we think about welfare provision in the very near future, where your reputation, which will be the total accumulation of all the data trails that you've left, will determine how it is that you are treated by various social and private institutions that you're dealing with. Right? So essentially, to put it in very simple terms, think about the logic of the credit score, which is, you know, a score you get when you before you apply for a loan, spreading beyond credit and now being applied to other domains and other activities. And with something like Uber, you actually already see that in action right now. You know that Uber, when you make a trip with Uber, not only can you rank the driver, but the driver also ranks you as a passenger, right? And the idea is that after many trips, you as a passenger accumulate a reputation, right? And it's the same, by the way, and you know, Airbnb is very popular in Barcelona. You also probably know very well that it's also the case with if you're renting an apartment. Not only can you evaluate the host, but also the host evaluates the guest, right? And the argument that companies like Uber make is that the reputation actually reflects the knowledge of the market. It reflects everything that the market knows about you as a participant, and by incorporating that data and that knowledge, you can actually punish people who deserve to be punished and let people who are the good, responsible citizens reap some rewards. right? And my fear is that, you know, and of course, if you think about how we've dealt with this problem in the past, if you look at how, you know, we've passed regulation a long time ago to limit what kind of data banks and other financial institutions can look at when they assess your credit availability, I mean, we've made legal efforts to do that, right, to protect it. The problem is that once we move to a paradigm where data just floats on secondary markets, you can go and buy it, people are collecting it and putting it what's known as personal data lockers in order to make money from it. We are moving to a very different world where it will be very hard to regulate this legally, right? So essentially we'll be stuck in a world where certain services and institutions might not want to deal with you because your reputation falls below a certain limit, right? And that reputation is something that is measured again by a total accumulation of everything that you've done that is collected somewhere in your profile. And if that's the future towards which we are heading, then I think the situation looks quite bleak, right? Because the defense made by Uber is that that's a much better way to deal with regulation. Right? Though instead of regulating proactively and telling drivers that they need to pass, you know, background tests, or they need to, you know, have insurance, they need to behave nicely, to have some kind of code of conduct, you can just say no. We need none of that. The market itself will police them because these people will have a reputation. Right? And that's basically the basic defense of Friedrich Hayek, actually, for the markets kind of either social justice or social planning. I mean, that's the entire point, that the markets just incorporate knowledge much better, and that knowledge can then help resolve whatever social conflicts appear, because the market actually rewards things and people justly. So for me, it's very hard not to look at the current set of developments that some would recognize or call the data revolution or the sharing economy or, you know, the all of the buzzwords like disruption that we see coming out of Silicon Valley, and located historically and very precisely in a certain stage of capitalism and neoliberalism. And it's very hard for me not to read those institutions and platforms as anything but something that provides a certain view on how A, regulation should function, the state should function, and how the citizens should behave, and that the citizens ought to be at the mercy of the market, and that our every single interaction with the market ought to be ranked, recorded, and stored somewhere, so that essentially our concern will not be just about every piece of data that we leave, but also about how that piece of data will affect our reputation, and how that reputation will then affect how we're treated by other actors. For me, this is a horror movie, right? For a lot of people on the other side, so to say, that's the paradise, right? Because you are not having any regulations in place. You can dispense with all these old rules that prevent more innovation, and you can move to this brand new world where data itself serves a policing function. And I'm saying all of that just to make us challenge the inevitability of one of those two options. Right? And I think we can find new ways in which we can actually have cities, for example, perform some of the functions that Uber performs by making the data about where passengers or citizens or inhabitants want to go available for other socially, let's put it, conscious ventures. And those ventures might actually be provided by the public. Right? There is no I see no reason why, for example, we should stick to the old world where buses go and pick people at bus stops, when you know you can probably calculate in real time who is where, who wants to go where, and pick them up as the bus goes along. I mean, so the old kind of planning, which Uber rightly criticizes, does not have to remain in place. You can move to a model of public transport that would actually rely on the data and technological infrastructure that is made possible by the fact that we have all those sensors in play, but that incorporates and embraces a very different social vision. And in many cities, well, at least in some, that's actually happening. If you look at Helsinki is actually, the city of Helsinki is trying to make a level playing field with their apps, right? And their apps actually do function not as an individual car that goes and picks up a passenger the way Uber goes and picks up a passenger, but it's a way to leverage the data signals that are coming from the phones of passengers who want to go somewhere else. It calculates the route, the optimal route for groups of people, and then collects people in groups rather than one by one. So it's a new form of public transport, somewhere between a bus and a taxi, that provides you all of the flexibility that is offered by information technology without any of the neoliberal craziness and rankings and ratings that you see with Uber. And I think our challenge is to figure out what are the venues and locations and organizations and institutions that can enact such models and put them in place, and what are the criteria that ought to be satisfied for such models even to emerge. And for me, it's obvious that such models are not going to emerge if one company captures all of the data. Right? They're just not, you will not be able to have the kind of Helsinki-like app if there is one company, let's say Google, capturing data about everything. Right? They're just going to use that data for their own services. Right? They're not going to make it available for everybody. But I'm also not sure that such a very different infrastructure and such a very different ecosystem can emerge if you just turn data into an asset and it's traded collectively, it is traded individually without actually contributing anything to the public good. Because again, I don't think that we have to pretend that we do not understand that a lot of the data that we generate individually, once it is pulled together and de-anonymized, it does have a huge public value, right? And you know, and Google is absolutely right to say that this data can help predict the outbreaks of influenza, or it can help predict the spread of fires, or perhaps it can even predict the state of the economy. The question is, why should that data stay with Google? Because the more of that data Google accumulates, the more indispensable it becomes to the solving of our own problems. Right? So as a society, very soon we discover that with Google having all the data, we actually have no means to be tackling all those problems, because all that prediction and all of that problem solving is happening in the private sector. Right? And the only way in which you can reincorporate and reintroduce some of that is by finding a way through which data and perhaps technology can serve as a publicly accessible, perhaps non-profit infrastructure on which other projects can emerge and operate. It's not going to happen if that data becomes locked up as private property, and it's not going to happen if that data becomes locked up in one giant server, Google, right? So, and unless we solve that question, I guarantee that almost every single domain of life, which by the way, Google is interested in entering, whether it's education, or whether it's health, or whether it's aging, or whether it's driving, I mean, I'm absolutely sure that given how much data Google already accumulates about you, very soon, they will also be entering industries like banking and insurance. To me, it's obvious, because they collect the kind of data that helps them to price risk. And I'm not particularly concerned about the banking industry being disrupted. Like, for some, it might actually be a good thing. But the way in which data is the paramount asset that allows this new set of players to essentially enter everything and be everywhere will transform how we live. It will transform how we solve problems, and my fear is that we will entirely abandon the old political model where instead of regulating the causes of the problems that we face, we will focus just on regulating the effects. Right? And what I mean by this is that, yes, we can be solving problems like climate change by regulating our smart meters. We can be solving problems like, problems with health, so obesity by regulating how much people walk. We can be regulating problems like terrorism by tracking who's most likely to blow up an airplane. But all of those problems have causes and root causes that are very different, right? And those causes are very complicated. And it used to be that when we believed in politics, we would actually go and try to figure out why climate change is happening. And we would go and try to do something about the companies that pollute or the lobbyists that corrupt the law. We would not just focus on making sure that the consumers have the best smart meters in their houses and can optimize their energy use. It's a complete replacement of the political with the market. For me, this is obvious. And data plays a crucial role here because data allows for the regulation of effects. It allows for prediction, And it allows through the technological infrastructure that we've built to accumulate that data to actually guide the behavior of us, the citizens. That's the entirety of our modern political system. That's how in the future Silicon Valley and a lot of politicians want us to solve big problems. They want to regulate what we do, because you know, we are ultimately the people who are over-consuming energy or overeating or doing all of those things, and not focusing on the actual causes, right? And I would argue that you know, there are far many more causes to problems like climate change or terrorism than you know, just the things that come up from analysis of individual behavior, right? It used to be that we would think about great causal models, history, mistakes, foreign policy, so forth. Right now, all of that is gone. We are focusing on what we can do with the data we have. And for a lot of people, it allows them to get by. Anyway, I think I'm already over time. So I'll just stop here by, again, emphasizing that unless we figure out the way in which both the technological infrastructure and the data that emerges out of it can remain in public hands, we're gonna have either neoliberalism where everybody is an entrepreneur, or we're gonna have neoliberalism where giant monopolies run everything. Like, there is no other alternative, because unless data is treated as this kind of common publicly accessible infrastructure, those are the choices that we'll face. So I'll stop here, and I'll be happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Sí, funciona. Ha sigut superestimulant, encara no hem paït a la velocitat que ens ha anat desgranant la quantitat d'idees tan absolutament estimulants i interessants que ens ha fet. A mi, mentre parlava, m'anava recordant tot el rato a un filòsof que ha estat escrivint, que és un filòsof coreà, que està afincat a Alemanya, que es diu Byung-Chul Han, i que ha escrit sobre la societat del cansament, que diu una cosa que té molt a veure amb el que el senyor Morozov ens ha dit en aquesta conferència. Ell ha dit que les dades que se'ns ofereixen com el gran punt màgic, el gran elixir que ens regalen per guanyar temps, és l'ham que tenen per agafar-se. El que ha passat, i això és l'experiència quotidiana de qualsevol persona, és que efectivament les tecnologies es faciliten molt la vida i ens ha fet guanyar temps. Però per què hem guanyat temps? Per fer més coses. I per fer més coses, quines coses? Per contemplar, per pensar més, per analitzar més el que ens passa en la vida? No, per fer més coses. És a dir, ara no anem en metro i estem mirant la tableta. Estem a una cua al cine i estem mirant el telèfon intel·ligent. És a dir, no tenim ja ni un sol moment lliure de pensament. Probablement ens han ficat en aquesta cinta en el que no parem de córrer per no moure's del lloc en el que estem i no ens n'adonem probablement d'això. El senyor Han diu que aquest és el nou model que ve. Hem passat de el que ell denomina la societat disciplinària, aquella en què l'economia s'organitzava de manera que la gent feia cas d'unes regles i un cop que havies complit amb el teu deure i amb la teva obligació ja podies quedar tranquil i anar-te'n a casa i gaudir del lleure, per exemple, o gaudir de la cultura o gaudir del que fos, hem passat a la societat del rendiment. Ell considera que en la societat disciplinària no hi havia més capacitat de créixer perquè els individus, respectant les normes, ja en tenien prou. En canvi, en la societat del rendiment és el propi individu el que assumeix que per tenir èxit, per competir, per tirar endavant, necessita tenir totes les eines tecnològiques i necessita, sobretot, no perdre ni una oportunitat de competir perquè, si no, la seva carrera cap a l'èxit està entrebancada o es pot veure compromesa. Aquesta és la idea que m'ha recordat molt quan ell parlava de com es governen les grans dades, aquest individu que assumeix lliurement, recordem com es repeteix aquests dies la cultura de l'emprenedoria, assumeix lliurement les cadenes i a més està encantat i enlluernat per aquestes cadenes. Clar, de fet, el tractament de les dades no és res diferent del tractament de les altres maneres de participació i d'empoderament de la societat. M'agradaria que vostè ara continués una miqueta el que ha sigut la seva conferència, reflexionant sobre com podem empoderar-nos, perquè clar, la solució fàcil és ser antitecnològics. Clar, ja sabem el que els hi va passar als que estaven en contra de la màquina de vapor, verdad? És a dir, això no porta enlloc, però com podem ser intel·ligentment resistents a un model tecnològic que ens fa que les pròpies tecnologies siguin la nostra soga al coll? Com ho fem?
Well, look, I think if you can sum up my 1 hour of intervention into one line, that line would be that everything that we take to be technological is actually deeply political, and that very often those of us who feel lazy or unnecessarily conservative just like to bash technology where there are many other better candidates to be bashed. So a lot of our debates tend to presume that since technology is the problem, we need to somehow find a way to recover some of that lost time or saved time of a promise, but it never came. So the response to that, of course, is usually more technology, which if you take my previous first remark that everything technological is political, is actually, it's not more technology, it's more politics, which in this day and age is neoliberalism, so you get more and more markets. So how do we deal with a problem like lack of privacy? Well, we encourage to buy phones that are absolutely secure, that cost a few thousand euros. We encourage to install specific apps on our tablets, and we encourage to pay for them. We encourage to pay to learn the skills, how to be secure. We encourage to perhaps learn how to use search engine optimization so that the most revealing aspects of our lives do not appear in the first page of Google. How do we deal with things like distraction? Well, we're again being encouraged to install specific apps on our computers that will limit our connectivity, how much time we spend online. We're being encouraged to go to various digital detox camps where we pay money to stay away from technology. We are being offered more and more market-driven solutions to problems that, to me, have been caused by markets in the first place. So that's, for me, is the reality in which we live. So if we continue framing this as a problem of technology, we will end up perpetuating this loop. And what I think we need to understand is that when we are complaining about fatigue, or when we're complaining about distraction, those are not natural features of things we call social media. I mean, I can easily design you a microblogging site that will not make you click every second to check what else has been tweeted about you. I mean, the reason why Twitter operates and Facebook operate on such a logic is because their business model operates on a very simple principle. The more clicks you make, the more they know about you, and the more they know about you, the more valuable you are to advertisers. So the entire design paradigm is optimized to make you click as many links as possible and make as many interactions with your friends, because every interaction is a piece of data. Right, so the distraction that we feel, that we always have this urge to go and update, refresh, check, click, all of that is not happening naturally. I mean, it's all engineered, and it's all engineered with one goal. It's engineered in the same way that gambling machines are engineered to be addictive. It's engineered in the same way that junk food is made to make you crave more of it. It's all done with a certain agenda. Right, so for me, the only way in which you can actually, you can, of course, focus on fatigue as a consequence of all of this, but it's not a natural feature of technology, and you can easily have a very different technological environment that does not lend itself to these features. And I think that, if you want to talk about solutions, solution number one, you have to frame the problem correctly. And if you frame the problem as a problem of technology, you're not making enough effort. Right? And I think that actually for Silicon Valley, it's very beneficial to frame it as a problem of technology, because that allows them to paint critics like me as technophobes, because they think that what we fear is not the worst excesses of neoliberalism, but you know, what we fear is, you know, modern dentistry and enlightenment and, you know, all of the good things that happen from progress. So when I go and try to criticize Google or Uber in their paradigm, I'm attacking the foundations of Western civilization as such, because I'm attacking science and technology and engineering, right? And this cover, moral cover that they use to constantly duck the issues, to me is very annoying. And I think that the least we can do is to try to cut through their bullshit, I mean, excuse my language, and actually present their program and paradigm for what it is. And what it is has nothing to do with technology. I'm sad to say.
Sí. Sobre, ha assenyalat molt clarament el tema de la importància dels frames en la batalla ideològica. De fet, discutir sobre Big Data o discutir sobre qui controla la informació que generem és parlar de qui controla, qui té un poder, qui exerceix el poder, diríem, no? I moltes vegades, quan la crítica es fa, la primera dificultat és enmarcar bé de què estem parlant en termes ideològics. I per això m'agradaria plantejar-li l'últim exemple que tenim de frame, de com el frame pot ser distorsionat. Com ell sap, senyor, com vostè sap, senyor Morozov, el Tribunal de Justícia de la Unió Europea ha sentenciat recentment que Google havia de respectar el dret a l'oblit dels ciutadans, i la dificultat que tenim és com fer-ho, diríem, des del punt de vista tècnic i organitzatiu. Però curiosament, quan el tribunal ha parlat del dret a l'oblit, els màxims dirigents de Google han sortit defensant el dret a saber com un dret ciutadà general, com si el dret a saber fos el que interessa a la ciutadania. De quin dret a saber estem parlant? Del dret de saber de Google i les empreses que li compren les dades, o el dret a saber nostre, d'aquests ciutadans que estem en aquesta sala, a poder clicar a Google la vida i miracles d'aquella persona que ens interessa? De què estem parlant? En aquest frame, com creu que hauríem d'actuar davant de Google? Hem de defensar el dret a l'oblit? Fins a on pot arribar el dret a saber? Fins a on podem permetre que arribi el dret a saber?
I mean, look, I think the very basic answer to a question is that, and I think the public perception is changing, but it's not changing as fast as I would like it to. The basic answer here is that we have to start treating technology companies in Silicon Valley with the same type of scrutiny that we treat any other industry, oil companies, Wall Street. Well, yes, yes. I mean, this is, they have an interest. They shape the public debate. And just because these people live in California and dress funnily and wear flip-flops does not make them any less evil than the Wall Street bankers who wear ties. I mean, apologies to those of you who are bankers. I mean, that's the, I mean, I'm sorry. I mean, like, for far too long, again, we allow them to constantly hijack the language and, you know, and present things that actually have nothing wonderful going for them as the next best thing since sliced cheese, you know? So disruption, what's so good about disruption? I don't know. I said the whole point of institutions like the welfare state was to minimize the amount of disruption we have in our lives, or at least minimize the consequences of it, right? I mean, disruption has never been prioritized by anybody but Schumpeterian entrepreneurs. Those are the people who want to treasure disruption for the sole reason that it's profitable. Like, that's not how we have thought about, you know, the welfare nets, how we thought about the social nets, how we thought about ways in which you can actually provide some kind of security about tomorrow in people's lives. That's why we have insurance, that's why we have unemployment. Well, we used to have insurance and employment benefits, but like, they're slowly moving away from us also. But I mean, that was the point of what we were trying to build, right? I mean, right now, as you move from the logic of protection to the logic of reputation, the idea is that, well, you have to work for yourself. You have to learn everything. You have to learn how to code. You have to learn how to hustle for attention on Twitter. You have to, you know, you have to be resourceful. That's the key neoliberal buzzword. If you're resourceful, no matter what hits you, you'll be fine. That's what Nicholas Taleb would say, you have to be anti-fragile. You know, so that whatever comes your way, whatever force tries to, you know, push you, you will still be able to survive it. And I just think that that's a very cruel way of, I mean, it's not just, I mean, forget cruel, it's just extremely unjust, because it would be fine to live in that society if we were not paying for all of the social institutions that are supposed to protect us. But the ridiculousness in which we live still implies that we keep paying taxes for supposedly social institutions to protect us, while the system itself is being reconfigured to suit a very different logic and agenda, right? So that, you know, we kind of pay for the welfare state, but it doesn't deliver, so we also have to invest into our own skills. Learning how to code, learning how to tweet, learning how to be funny, learning how to, you know, get a job in the sharing economy, all of that is there. So, I mean, it doesn't really answer your question about the right to be forgotten. And here I think, you know, all I can say is that what I don't want to happen is have Google as the ultimate judge as to what constitutes public interest and what doesn't, because right now they are. I mean, that's the unfortunate consequence of the judgment. I mean, like, you do need to have an independent layer. I mean, again, how to make that layer truly independent is a task that's beyond me, but I mean, that's at least how it should work in theory, right? You need to have a public institution that will not just be doing the populist tricks that Google does every day. But just before we open up, I just want to say, to emphasize something that you said when you were talking about Han and the society of fatigue. I mean, it's absolutely true that the key to understanding the contemporary situation is to draw the relationship between three variables. It's data, it's money, and it's time. And that also shows you how work enters into it. Like, those are, like, if you want to think of, like, where Marxism would go next or should go next, or where I was going to succeed it, that's the formula. You have to figure out how money relates to time and how it relates to data. This is, the, to me, the key three variables that you need to understand to figure out what's happening in capitalism today. And the way in which data right now is being converted into time, and the way in which it is being assigned a monetary value, is the most interesting development that I see in terms of how, you know, it's not just we are still in the age of immaterial labor and, you know, all of the stuff we've been talking about in the 90s and, you know, in the last decade. I mean, right now, you clearly see that there is value that is being generated. And, like, who knows? I mean, the vision that Google has for the future is probably that, you know, we work very occasionally and the value that we derive comes entirely from our data portfolio. Right? I mean, the only question there is, like, where does actually money come from? Like, if all we do is just hustle our own data, like, who's interested in buying it? But that's a question that Google doesn't want to answer. But that's a very, I mean, to me, it's the most interesting question. The way in which all the data that's collected about us, how it connects to the fact that society is accelerating. We are running out of time. The expectation is that we have to do more and more work. You do have more disintermediation. I mean, to me, it's like you have to be blind not to see that as society gets digitized and technologized, you yourself are doing more and more work through self-check-ins at airports, self-checkouts at supermarkets. I mean, all of that to me is like, you might think that that's saving time, but it's also pushing more and more work on the shoulders of the individuals. I don't want to sort of go on about it forever, but I just want to say that, like, this relationship, money, time, data, and seeing it through the perspective of work, to me, is like, that's where the best minds should look for the next 5-10 years. Like, that's the, we don't know. It's not like we know, we have no clue. But I think that's the key to figure out.
Sí, el que pasa es que aquest paradigma del mercat de les dades està basat sobre una premissa que potser no es verificarà i que és contradictòria amb el propi sistema que l'organitza. I és que perquè les nostres dades siguin interessants per algú, hem de ser consumidors. Les dades tenen a veure amb la nostra identitat com a consumidors, res més, no interessa res més que el que consumirem i el que farem. No? Llavors, en una societat, com ens ha explicat el professor Stiglitz o com ens ha explicat també Thomas Piketty, en el que creixen les desigualtats i en les que probablement l'economia dels propers dècades, les properes dècades, no estarà en condicions de garantir que importants sectors, de garantir que tota la societat tindrà feina i podrà consumir, sinó més aviat la perspectiva que, en la que s'avança és que hi haurà amplíssims sectors que estaran exclosos, què farem amb aquesta gent que les seves dades no ens interessen per res perquè no podran comprar res ni faran res? Això em porta a plantejar la qüestió de les desigualtats i també de com la tecnologia d'internet pot contribuir o no a aquesta dinàmica d'increment de les desigualtats. Es diu que la informació creix exponencialment i que gràcies a internet i a les xarxes tenim accés, qualsevol persona té accés a la millor informació, i és veritat. Qualsevol de vostès pot entrar a la biblioteca de Harvard o a la publicació de l'últim equip d'investigació neurològica i llegir l'últim treball que s'ha fet sobre allò. Tot això és cert. El problema és que per tenir informació rellevant que ens pugui ser útil necessitem un nivell de coneixements previs que no tenim ni que no estem en condicions de garantir a la gent. Llavors, quin paper creu que poden jugar en el futur les noves tecnologies en els mecanismes d'inclusió i exclusió social?
Well, I mean, look, we should not overlook the fact that, as you point out, the kind of information that's out there for the taking has increased dramatically. I mean, I would not challenge the fact that there is much more stuff to be found today on Google than you had access to 10 or 15 years ago. That said, I mean, it does not necessarily, you see, the tricky thing here is that much again depends on how you frame the question of digital divide, right, which has defined this debate for probably two decades now, right? And a lot of people in Silicon Valley, if you talk to them, they will say that there is no problem of digital divide because the problem of digital divide was entirely a question of connectivity. So if we can get everybody connected, which is kind of happening through smartphones, we have solved the problem of digital connectivity. Like, to me, that sounds absurd because it completely neglects all of the other trends that have to do with proprietization of knowledge that are happening digitally. It's like saying that, well, we've solved the problem of inequality and accessibility because now everybody can go and enter a mall and, you know, buy things occasionally. I mean, like, to me, it's not solving the problem of accessibility, right? It's you're solving the problem of making it more accessible for people to enter the mall. It does not solve the problem of actually getting goods into the hands of people who need it. So if you look at how companies like Facebook, for example, have been framing their efforts to promote what they call the human right to connectivity, right? It sounds great. I mean, shouldn't we think that connectivity is a human right? I mean, let's just all sign up and have another UN summit. I mean, it all sounds fascinating, right? I mean, the problem is that once you look at the actual details, what it is that Facebook is promoting with its embrace of the right of connectivity, you clearly see that what it means is that, well, everybody has a right to connect to Facebook. Everything else comes at a price, right? So if you look at the partnerships that Facebook is striking with mobile operators and with a lot of mobile companies in the developing world, in Africa, in Latin America, in Asia, what you would see is that their proposition is very simple. They are happy to make Facebook itself free on smartphones to people in the developing world while charging you for any other app that you use, right? So in essence, think about what it means. Anybody who wants to reach people in the developing world now will have to go through Facebook because Facebook comes for free, while other services and apps you have to pay for, which also means that if you want to start up with do you know, some kind of educational startup, you would want to show MOOCs or video courses or things like that, your first choice would be to go through Facebook because Facebook doesn't charge you for traffic, which also means that now suddenly, in the context of learning and studying, you're also leaving a data trail that you didn't leave before. Because in the past, right, the expectation was not that there will be an intermediary like Facebook that will record every single thing that you do, right, while you study. That was not an expectation. Now it is an expectation. And then, you know, you of course move into the third layer, and then, you know, you have startups that come in and say, well, since a lot of people in the developing world don't have a credit history, we can actually look at their Facebook activity to predict whether they're credit worthy or not, right? And offer them loans. And a lot of actual companies do that already, which means that now everything that you do on Facebook in one way or another affects the likelihood of you obtaining the only possible loan you will ever get in your life if you live in Africa or parts of Latin America or Asia. Right? And for me, again, that sounds crazy because, again, it subsumes the entirety of your everyday life onto the paradigm of debt and credit. To me, that's simple. So the fact that you're making more people bankable, as Silicon Valley would say, to me, it's kind of irrelevant because there is a reason why they need credit in the first place, and very often is because there are already existing injustices in their society, and those injustices are not being addressed at all. So the fact that you can make it easier for people to get access to credit in itself, to me, does not question the logic of that, which I think it's time for us to question, and we have been questioning somewhat in the more radical circles for a couple of years, right? But if you look at these companies, look at the company like Zest Finance, the startup launched by the former chief information officer of Google called Douglas Merrill. So it's a startup which basically their motto, and that's an actual quote from the founder, is all data is credit data. They look at 80,000 points, data points, things, you know, how quickly you move your mouse in your browser when you fill in an application form, what browser you use, how large are your fonts. They have 80,000 of those data points. And based on those data points, they determine how likely you are to default on the loan that a bank or someone else would give you. So now they just serve as an intermediary. For me, the very premise that all data is credit data is crazy. Like, I'm sorry, like I just cannot accept that premise, right? Because it means that there is no limit on everything that you do. Like, everything you do can be subsumed within that logic. So, you know, when you ask questions about inequality, I think they're very important because it's not enough to be making the current situation more bearable. Because ultimately, you know, in the long term, you might actually be making things worse, right? So, and that's the thing with technology. I mean, that's what I've been trying to say in my talk, that yes, the data and the feedback loops and the sensors and the amount of information that's being accumulated has a monetary value. And, you know, yes, of course, we as citizens and users can reap some of that value. So, I mean, and so the fact that it makes our lives a little bit more livable, to me, is not in itself an argument. Right? It's not. It's like saying that, well, you know, it's very noisy outside. Now we can 3D print earplugs and give them to everybody so that people can actually protect themselves from noise. Like, for me, that's not the way to deal with noise. If you want to deal with noise, you actually go and investigate what it is that's noisy. Right? You don't just hand out earplugs. And the problem is that, you know, sensors, apps, and data right now are the earplugs of our generation. I mean, that's what they do. They let us deal with the effects of the problems and have a good time occasionally without doing anything about the effects, without doing anything about the causes. And to me, this is like, I mean, that's the end of politics. And if we don't realize that, then, you know, it's it's very sad. That's that truly the end of history is here, if that's the paradigm in which we operate.
El final de la historia. La veritat és que tot ens porta a la política, finalment, no? És evident. Jo continuaria preguntant-li 50.000 coses que tinc aquí pensades, però penso que és l'hora de donar la veu a l'audiència, que vostès puguin fer les preguntes, perquè segur que tenen coses interessants que preguntar. Endavant. Sisplau, esperin que arribi el micròfon, perquè així arribarà el so a la cabina de traducció. Sí, algú vol fer la primera pregunta? Sí. Allà, allà.
Shooting, they say shooting. It translated it as shooting.
Hago la pregunta en castellano o en inglés.
Sí, sí, tranquilo.
Ok, en castellano. Quizá ha indicado, ¿no?, de una manera un poco más o menos sutil, ¿no?, que parte de su crítica es básicamente hacia el modo, la economía o la política del neoliberalismo, como, digamos, de qué modo esto afecta en al cómo se tratan los datos y qué efecto tiene esto en la economía o las relaciones que nosotros tenemos con el resto de las personas, ¿no? Y digamos, mi pregunta sería, ha dicho que quizá el modo de tratar hiperprivatizar los datos no es bueno. Dejar que una sola empresa o un par de empresas tenga todos los datos tampoco es bueno. ¿Cuál es el término medio? ¿Tiene alguna idea de cuál es el término medio?
¿Hay términos medios?
Sure. Well, I think I've tried to answer it in my talk. At the end, maybe it wasn't clear enough. But I do think that there are other ways of arranging property relations. And you know, this is where you do need to start looking into all sorts of experimentation around social ownership and around, you know, the common. I mean, it's not a revolutionary insight. It's the kind of approach that, I mean, yes, radical social movements, but still social movements have been trying to apply to other kinds of infrastructure. I mean, to me, it's not obvious that water, for example, ought to be treated as an asset. It's not obvious that it ought to be privatized, and it's not obvious to me that it's a commodity to be traded. Like, it's not obvious to me that data is a commodity to be traded, and it doesn't mean that you cannot have some kind of a economy and some kind of, you know, maybe even for-profit, or no, not for-profit, but like some kind of revenue-generating enterprise delivering it. But it also does not mean that we do not have other paradigms to think about data. That's why I said, I mean, what's being, look, the situation we're in right now is that everybody hates Silicon Valley for reasons that I think have more to do with confusion about politics than with actual issues. I mean, you have a lot of industries who hate Silicon Valley because they're about to get disrupted. You know, you have a lot of politicians who hate it. For a lot of people, it's a kind of, especially in Europe, it's a very nice populist cause that can show that they are still in charge and they can regulate things. And here, basically, the social democrats. Yes, so I mean, they all want to regulate Google because they think Google is the enemy, right? The problem is that just because Google is the enemy doesn't necessarily mean that the other alternative is much better. So when you have critics like Jaron Lanier, for example, you know, who is another popular writer and critic, come up with an approach that says, well, Google is leveraging all of our data. They need to share it with us, so we all need to start trading it. To me, like, I can only read it as neoliberalism in disguise. Just because it bashes Google doesn't make it any less neoliberal. I mean, that just shows you that, you know, there are strands within neoliberal thought, as we have always known, that are sensitive to the issue of monopoly. The fact that these guys hate monopolies, which in this case Google, does not make them any less neoliberal, because they already buy into the idea that it's a commodity that ought to be sold, traded, there needs to be a profit motive in it, there needs to be money made from it, and I just refuse to accept that, right? And you know, in Europe, and in Spain, I mean, you know this much better than I do. I mean, there is a long tradition of various alternative practices, social centers, squatting, whatever. I'm not saying that that's, you know, the entirely applicable to the world of data. But for me, like, that's the source of inspiration for thinking about how you can actually have a way that does not default into it's a private ownership owned by you, the entrepreneur, or it's owned by one big monopoly that derives benefits from it. Like, you know, there is certainly, like, because both of them are way of privatizing things, right? Regardless of how much anxiety and hatred there is currently about Silicon Valley, like, it doesn't necessarily mean that leaving it in somebody else's hands is a better alternative, right? Well, sure.
Cuando habla de provecho, ¿no? De value, se refiere al provecho de una sola persona o de una compañía, pero es quizá, digamos, ¿qué otra medida hay en relación a lo social? ¿Qué otra medida hay para saber si es bueno para la sociedad?
Gracias.
Yeah.
Okay, so in English.
Yeah,
okay.
No,
I got it,
Okay.
I mean, look, again, I'll try to be very quick. I mean, much depends on whether you mean profit for individual or profit for a company. I mean, again, when you talk about not treating certain things as commodities, I mean, there are alternative ways to think about the issue. You can say that selling your kidney, for example, like, is not a good idea, regardless of whether you're making a profit or not, right? Again, that's a kind of moral critique that I'm not going into, right? But, you know, whether you make a profit or not here is not a factor, because the critique is essentially about the morality of the act and the moral status of the object, and it's not about whether you're making a profit or not. When it comes to data, I'm not sure which of the which of the explanations, the moral one or the kind of political one, deserves more emphasis, and that's something that's entirely open. But you know, as we know, with efforts to stop privatization of attempts to privatize water in Italy, for example. I mean, yes, it is provided by a handful of companies, but those companies are not allowed to make a profit of it, right? I mean, they can have guarantees, blah, 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 but I mean, it's not sort of rampant privatization where they can charge whatever rates they want, right? I mean, so there are alternative models, and I would be more than happy to us to consider an experiment with them. Right now, that experimentation is not happening because people hate Silicon Valley so much that they assume that that alternative must be better just because it does not involve Silicon Valley. And to me, this is crazy.
Gracias. Y aquí una pregunta, sí.
Yes, very short. In view of the data, well, the developments of the data market, do you think that the laws on data protection that the European Union and the majority of member countries are passing, do you think these laws are completely useless, or they still have some sense?
Look, I don't think that they're useless. The problem is that, I mean, they're not useless in at least taming one of the two options. So, I mean, the option where there is one big monopoly called Google that sucks in all the data and that has one giant database that integrates data from every single activity that you do and then produces insights as to what you should be doing next. The data protection laws here clearly help to avoid, I mean, not avoid that, but to, it can be even more drastic if there were no data protection laws in Europe. The problem is that if you move to the other end of the spectrum, the other option that I outlined, where you have individual entrepreneurs eager to sell their own data, I just don't know how data protection is going to stop people from essentially selling themselves into some kind of data slavery. I mean, if you can capture your own data through some kind of monitoring device, then yes, you can sort of forbid the manufacturer of the device and regulate the manufacturer of the device. How are you going to regulate the individual? I mean, you can impose all sorts of, you know, you can try to do it the way in some European countries we prevent people from selling themselves into slavery or selling their organs or, I don't know, entering prostitution, whatever. I mean, that's the alternative you have. The thing is that with data, how are you going to enforce that? Like, I don't know. So, I'm not saying that data protection laws are irrelevant. They're very relevant in averting at least one of the two horrible scenarios that I consider horrible. Some people don't. But I just don't see how it helps us tackle everybody's entrepreneur in charge of their own data issue. Maybe I'm just missing something in terms of European data protection laws, but I just don't see how it's gonna, like, what do they have to tell me to prevent me from collecting how many steps I take every day and then selling it? Like, how? They can prevent Google, they cannot prevent me. And if the paradigm is that I have to collect it and make money off of it, then people will be doing it regardless.
Sí. Hola. Resulta que l'empresa Apple no paga impostos al lloc del món. I aquí a Barcelona té una gran botiga a plaça Catalunya. Llavors jo li preguntaria què li diria vostè a les persones que compren productes d'Apple, sabent el que passa, i si els amos d'aquesta companyia tenen algun dret social, per dir-ho d'alguna forma. O sigui, ja que ells no paguen res a la societat, si tenen dret a rebre alguna cosa. I un altre respecte de l'aigua, resulta que aquí el cost de l'aigua és caríssim. O sigui, encara que no es consumeixi, hi ha uns recàrrecs importantíssims. Llavors, com es pot lluitar en contra d'això? Gràcies.
Aquesta última qüestió, no sé si és So, I mean, look, as I said, for me, these companies are not angels, and they are probably the opposite. So the fact that they don't pay taxes, they have horrible working conditions. I mean, regulations when it comes to trade unions, for example, as we now know with Amazon in Europe. I mean, all of that to me is clear. I don't know, to be honest, how much you can expect from our beloved governments in terms of taming them, in part because our beloved governments have problems taming many other industries whose evilishness, if you will, is much more obvious. So I would love to tell you that the European Commission and the governments would be able to do it, but I just don't have that faith, to be honest. So, but in terms of direct action, by quoting them, and you know, what would I pay to people who shop there? Yes, I mean, we can convert it into some kind of let's boycott Apple issue, and I think it will have some effect. The bigger problem, I think, is that when it comes to data, again, to bring it back to the data issue, it will be like it much depends on the kind of language that these movements embrace. And my fear is that very often right now, much of the critique of these companies focuses on issues like monopoly and antitrust, which themselves already established the economic paradigm as the default paradigm by which we should assume the evaluate the activities and the impact of those companies. So, which means that the benchmark is basically consumer welfare. So the lower prices you pay if you use Amazon, you know, the commission has, you know, and if you follow strictly the kind of American letter of the antitrust law, it's not such a bad thing because consumers pay less, right? And the monopoly is precisely the vehicle that allows consumers to pay less. Of course, that reduces consumers and, well, it reduces users to just consumers and completely loses on the sort of broader citizenship question, right? And for me, it's obvious that, you know, if we accept that, you know, we do live in a social democracy and that we have kind of a capitalist regime, but we're trying to mitigate its worst consequences, then, you know, it's clear to me that the reason why we pay a little bit extra for books or other goods is precisely because this is what it takes to preserve the kind of cultural infrastructure in place that allows publishers to take risks on risky books, that allows independent bookstores to actually survive and sell some books that would not otherwise be seen. I mean, all of those are the kind of features of the current ecosystem that are solely about questions of quality that are very hard to evaluate by looking at whether this book costs €6 or €5, right? And as long as we frame it as solely a question of efficiency and prices, we in Europe are never going to defeat these companies because these companies will produce superb value and will charge very little for it. And, you know, so that's why I'm not that excited about European regulators constantly coming back and framing these issues as we should do what's in the interest of consumers. Like, we, you know, that's what we've been doing for the last two decades and look at the results. I mean, you know, you have to discover other sources of value other than the price, because if you do not have other sources of value other than the price, then you are already operating in a neoliberal paradigm where the only thing that can be assessed is precisely the price value. Anyway, sorry, I didn't answer your question about water. I just have no answer.
Com que ara hi ha poc temps i veig que hi ha més mans que abans i més que recollirem dos o tres preguntes alhora, perquè si no, primer n'hi ha una aquí, aquesta, després una altra allà darrere, una altra i una altra. Bueno, fem aquestes tres primer, si us plau, sigueu molt breus perquè si no, no tindrem temps i també li demanaria al senyor Morozov que fes contestes curtes perquè se'ns acaba el temps i encara hi ha un parell de preguntes més per contestar.
Bona tarda. Primerament, Eugeni, moltes gràcies per la conferència que ens has fet avui a la tarda. Has dit en un moment d'aquesta que com a societat descobrirem que quan Google tingui totes les nostres dades, nosaltres quedarem absolutament despullats. Jo voldria posar dos exemples d'empreses referents en el seu àmbit, de les xarxes socials, que han tingut comportaments diferents. Instagram, la xarxa que s'utilitza més per compartir fotografies, quan va anunciar que vendria les seves imatges amb fins comercials, els usuaris hi va haver una revolta brutal que van aconseguir parar l'objectiu de l'empresa. I de l'altra banda, quan WhatsApp, que és la xarxa de missatges més utilitzada al món, era fins fa poc temps la líder indiscutible. Quan va començar a aplicar tarifes de pagament pels seus serveis i que com a contrapartida doncs, no vendria les dades que obtenia, ràpidament va aparèixer una altra xarxa, Line, que feia absolutament igual que ella, però sense cost. És a dir, els usuaris, quan van veure que s'havia de pagar, encara que fos un cost ridícul, perquè no era ni un euro a l'any, llavors es van abocar massivament a una altra xarxa. Llavors, és a dir, com podem els ciutadans estar protegits? Perquè d'una banda volem molta protecció, però per l'altra no estem disposats a pagar un preu, encara que sigui de forma irrisòria. Moltes gràcies.
Hola, bona tarda. Bueno, més o menys volia dir que ara mateix estem bastant criticant Google, no? com a companyia i està bé, però el que ens falta és una crítica a nosaltres mateixos, com ha dit el senyor davant. Una crítica a nosaltres mateixos com persones que utilitzem tecnologia, les noves tecnologies. Per exemple, segur que n'hi ha moltíssima gent que critica Google, però continuem utilitzant el seu servei d'email, continuem utilitzant els seus smartphones, continuem utilitzant el seu cercador. Doncs quina és la solució? Jo per sort sóc informàtica i he pogut migrar de les serveis de Google serveis personals i alternatius. Però clar, n'hi ha moltíssima gent que encara utilitza l'email de Google. I fins i tot jo vull tenir una conversa privada, meus emails arriben a Google perquè la gent els que envio utilitza el servei d'email de Google. Doncs quina seria la solució en aquest cas?
La senyora del darrere.
Hi. You mentioned that nationalizing data would be like the other option, but I'm actually thinking that our beloved governments would have a really great tool by having all our data or knowing
they already have your data at the NSA, but yes.
Yes, well, it would be very helpful to predict what we are going to vote, for instance. So, mm-hmm. But my question is basically, should we really lobby for fundamental right as the right of anonymity, or at least having the right to click and not be available for everyone, or our data not to be available for everyone.
Mm-hmm. Do we take more or do we answer? Yeah, I answer or do we take more?
No, espera, com que veig que hem consumit molt de temps, fem les dues preguntes que queden perquè si no, no tindrem temps. Sí, sorry.
So what, I answer, there is one
yeah,
more.
There are two more questions okay. Here. Sí.
Well, thank you for your conference. Congratulations. I want to ask you a simple thing. What is the role of politics? Do you think that politics has to protect our rights simply? By putting, for example, laws, but also by denouncing in the countries the bad uses of law with civil actions, like in USA or something like that.
Gràcies. I acabem, ara sí.
Muy, muy simple y muy corto, pero en inglés. Have you encountered hope for this dark situation anywhere in your research in terms of places that have, let's say, the beginning of visions that could end up being as strong as those visions that technological companies at the moment push, which seem to be the only visions that are the strong ones at the moment?
Yes. Okay, so I'll try.
Gracias.
Do we have more? No? Okay. So I'll try to provide an answer that might actually answer some of those questions and one hopefully coherent line. So to start with the question about hope, look, again, if you go back to my one-line summary of what I've said, that everything technological is in one way or another actually deeply political. If you want hope and if you want alternatives, you need money. To me, it's very simple. If you want to have more platforms that do not make their money through advertising, if you want to have platforms that are feature privacy and security by design, if you want to have platforms that are decentralized and do not depend on one centralized server, you need money, you need people. And we have people who can build them, we have lots of people who can build them. Why does that money not find those people? And of course, we can ask questions, well, it doesn't find those people because we need a better Kickstarter. I think that's not a good way to frame it, because there is money that we as taxpayers pay, right? And we pay it to fund infrastructure. We pay a lot of that money, it goes to the European Commission. Where does that money go from the European Commission? Well, to be very blunt, it goes back to national telecom monopolies who cannot take this money as subsidies, so it goes back to them under the banner of research and development funds. Why does it happen? Because these people have lobbies sitting in key committees deciding on who gets that money. So I mean, like, there is plenty of, I have plenty of hope, yes. I mean, we can build all of those technologies and platforms. It's not happening for a very simple reason, and it's not happening for the same reason that we have all those other problems that have to do with banking and then finance and everything else, right? And that brings us back to the question that the gentleman behind you asked about the role of the state in regulating all of this. Like, I wish that we could just pretend that we can pass a bunch of laws and it will solve all those issues, but it's not gonna happen. Because again, here I think it's not really a question of, I mean, passing laws, because as I said, what we're dealing with questions like people selling their own data, it's gonna be very hard to regulate. Like here you have, I mean, like the laws you need are new constitutional forms providing for new types of social ownership, which, by the way, does not mean nationalization. I never said the word nationalization once in my entire speech. So the idea behind the common is actually very different. I have no faith in the nation state. I'll come out with that greatest acknowledgement. Like, so I have no faith in nationalization. First of all, I don't think it's realistic, and B, I don't think that, you know, the state at this point can be trusted as much as I don't like libertarianism. That's like where we are. Right? So the only solutions that we can have will require new legal, I mean, some, it's not like new. I mean, Latin America is far away on the idea of social ownership, and so are parts of Europe. Italy is actually not that bad on that front, because you do have some jurists who are working on that issue for a very long time. But broadly, situation is very bad, but it's bad for all of the same reasons that situation on other fronts is bad. And that's why what I'm trying to say, it's not so much a question of us not understanding something about technology. The thing that we do not understand maybe is that, you know, it's politics in disguise, right? So to come back to the questions that you and the person next to you asked, I mean, yes, I wish I could engage in some kind of moralizing and tell people, well, you should all stop using all these services provided by Google. I just don't find myself comfortable doing that for the simple reason that these services are useful. Like, if you really are short of time, which as overworked as most of us are, we are, like, those services do provide great value. And like, to ask people who actually at the sort of forefront of is thinking about these issues politically and socially, to tell them, well, guys, you have to tie your own hands and fight capitalism and fight all those other sort of problematic things with your hands behind your back. Like, it's not going to happen. I mean, look, then you'll end up with Richard Stallman, a guy who, you know, for all the right ideas, refuses to use a graphical browser because he thinks that compromises his morality. Like, and you end up with somebody like Richard Stallman, full of his good ideas, being completely outmaneuvered by hucksters like Tim O'Reilly with his 1 million followers on Twitter. That's the reality of things. So, like, as much as I would like to tell all of you, stop using Google, and you probably should, but like, for me, that's not politics. That's not what politics is about, and politics is also not consumer activism. It's not just about threatening to leave Instagram or, you know, the, what's the, WhatsApp, you know, when they threaten to introduce prices. I mean, like, look, I mean, both of them ended up being bought by Facebook, and the reason why Facebook bought them is for their data. Right, so the fact that no cash changes hands, user profiles, whatever, I mean, for me it's data. So the fact that no cash changes hands does not mean that no money changes hands. Right? Or there's no monetary value changes hands. I mean, clearly, $18 or $19 billion does not just, you know, that valuation does not just come out of nowhere. It comes out of a certain set of assumptions as to where the value resides, and that value resides in data, I'm afraid to say. And once that data is integrated with the rest of Facebook data, that data is even more powerful and valuable. So again, I do not want to discourage you from thinking about great acts of boycotting and consumer activism and all of that, but I also don't want us to end up in a situation where you know, we adopt this posture of ethical consumption, or, you know, like the sort of death paradigm that supposedly helped us deal with the climate change problem. Like, it hasn't. Like, you cannot solve this issue just by tinkering with the consumers and what they do, because to do that would be precisely to buy into the paradigm that just wants to focus on the effects and abandon the causes. So.
Gràcies, Eugeni Morozov, per aquestes 2 hores d'intensíssima reflexió. Són les 9:01, per tant, hem arribat al final del temps. Permeti'm, espero que tots hagin tingut el goig intel·lectual que jo he tingut, com diu el professor Wagensberg, si alguna cosa produeix plaer és el goig intel·lectual, i espero que l'hagin tingut, espero que a més els sigui útil. Em permeto recomanar un llibre que amplifica el discurs del senyor Morozov en l'àmbit de l'ètica. És un llibre que s'ha publicat recentment, que és del professor Michael Sander, un bioètic americà, que ha escrit un llibre titulat Lo que el dinero no puede comprar, i que també té relació amb el que hem parlat avui aquí. I permetin recomanar-los la següent sessió, perquè va molt al fil també de lo que deixem ara penjat. És una sessió que tindrà com a protagonista a Daniel Innerarity, filòsof, que ha publicat bastants llibres. Jo un dels que m'ha agradat més és El futuro y sus enemigos, perquè parla de com la societat de la urgència ens està atrapant en un present que no es permet projectar-nos cap al futur. Bé, els hi recomano vivament, no és perquè jo també hi sigui, sinó perquè penso que el professor Innerarity mereix molt la pena, com mereixen molt la pena tots els seus llibres, i els espero aquí el proper, dintre de 15 dies, dijous. Gràcies a tots, gràcies al professor Morozov, i que gaudeixin del que avui hagin pogut aprendre i reflexionar. Gràcies.